The next item of business is consideration of business motion 13215 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak on the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 13215 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed, and the next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the BMA Scotland survey, which found that 30 GP practices consider their position to be precarious following the pausing of the GP sustainability loan scheme.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We greatly value the contribution general practice makes to the nation's health and want to ensure GP practices have the support that they need. This is why we intend to resume tranche one of the sustainability loan scheme in 24-25 once we have completed the disbursement of funds for the loans already completed and confirmed a budget. This will not likely be until midway through the financial year. Our preference remains to continue the loan scheme into tranche 2 and beyond. However, this will depend on whether the UK Government resumes the allocation of financial transaction capital to the Scottish Government.
Tess White.
Cabinet Secretary, with massive cuts to health board budgets, reduced funding for primary care, rising overheads and ongoing recruitment and retention issues, GP surgeries are desperate for support to make them sustainable. It beggars belief that this SNP government would press pause on the scheme, and it's a hammer blow to GPs when primary care is in crisis. Clinicians have told me that patients will come to harm because of this SNP government's spending decisions. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept this? And will he restart the loan scheme process immediately?
Cabinet Secretary.
There are a number of points there from Tess White. The first is to recognise the undoubted pressure and demand that there is upon general practice. I've visited a number over recent weeks and indeed met with Dr Buist on a number of occasions regarding this particular issue on sustainability loans, but also on the general situation across primary care. I've already set out in terms of our intention regarding moving forward on the sustainability loan scheme. Austerity has a consequence. We've seen a 62%, near two-thirds reduction in financial transactions. That has a direct consequence into the availability of funding we're able to pass on. However, we're very keen to be able to reopen this, to be able to make sure we continue to support those practices in a scheme that is unavailable, certainly in England, and I believe elsewhere in the UK as well.
Tess White.
Cabinet Secretary, the reality is that rural and remote communities are being hit especially hard by this crisis in primary care, and you can't pass the buck. Across the north of Scotland, Birkhead and Hopeman surgeries in Moray have closed. Others have handed back their contracts, such as Braemar and Old Meldrum. Scotland has lost around 100 GP practices in the last 10 years. This is a crisis presided over by this Central Belt SNP government. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell GPs and patients today, is he committed to keeping GP surgeries open and ensuring care is kept as close to home as possible, because we cannot afford to lose any more GP surgeries?
Cabinet Secretary.
In short, yes, I am. And I don't accept the assertion that Tess White makes about this government. I'm a Cabinet Secretary originally from Orkney. You could hardly count me as being overly Central Belt orientated. The point remains, though, that the finances that are available to us are being reduced by the UK government. The block grant allocation is down, and our financial transactions are reduced by 62%. That has a consequence in terms of what we're able to pass on. We have, of course, brought in more progressive taxation to raise additional funds, opposed by the Conservative Party, that mean that we are able to pass on a real terms increase to our health boards to provide support. And in spite of that, I recognise that there are still challenges. Of course, we will continue to do what we can to support GP practices and primary care, because I said in the outset, they make an invaluable contribution to our health service and ensure that we avoid people needing to be moving on to other parts of the health service. But that is made all the more difficult by the continued fiscal choices that are being made by Westminster governments.
Thank you. I'm keen to bring in as many members as possible. Concise questions and responses will help. And I call Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update regarding the Scottish Government's latest engagement with the UK Government regarding the significant reductions to the funding stream for this scheme? And can he provide assurances that the Scottish Government will press the UK Government for this funding to resume?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. Yes, the Scottish Government, as I've outlined, has seen a 62% reduction to our financial transaction allocation since 22-23. In March, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government called on the UK Government to provide clarity around the future of our FT allocation and to increase investment in capital projects. However, the UK Government's spring statement provided no clarity, no additional capital or FT funding for Scotland. Coupled with our real terms reduction in capital funding, we'll have to continue making tough decisions to reprioritise our infrastructure pipeline to ensure we spend within the limited funding available. And unfortunately, we don't see much light coming from a future Labour government either. They're wedded to the Tory fiscal choices.
Jackie Bailey.
Let me shine a light on the proceedings then, Presiding Officer, because Audit Scotland say that the SNP will fail to recruit the promised 800 GPs by 2027. Indeed, the BMA say that we actually need 1,000 GPs to meet the increased demand. The GP loan scheme is about sustainability. It is about retention of GPs. So does the Cabinet Secretary think the suspension of the scheme helps in any way? And can he guarantee that the Helensburgh GP practice will get the loan that they were promised and that they need?
Cabinet Secretary.
There's 2 points there that I would address from Jackie Bailey. The first is that we're making progress in terms of the recruitment of new GPs. That is up. And we've got a record 1,200 GPs in training, which is good news that I'm sure Jackie Bailey would wish to welcome. I absolutely understand the correlation between investment in practices and recruitment and retention. I absolutely understand that. And I'm not where I would want to be in terms of what is happening with the GP sustainability loans scheme. I am committed to extending it and to moving into tranche two, but we need further commitment from the UK Government around financial transactions. I'm sure she will join me in calling on the current UK Government and indeed a future UK Government to make sure that that materialises.
Question number two, Paul O'Kane.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that the Scottish Men's Sheds Association could collapse due to the withdrawal of Scottish Government funding.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
The Scottish Government has provided £795,000 worth of funding to the Scottish Men's Shed Association since 2016, supporting the movement to grow from 5 sheds to 200 across Scotland. We understand it's a very challenging time for small organisations and that the SMSA are working to secure funding from charity donors and from the private sector. Given this, I can confirm today that we will work with the organisation to identify and to provide the funding for this financial year to ensure that we support them in the months ahead to develop broad, sustainable support for this important national organisation. And we hope this will help to avoid future uncertainty and assist local sheds to flourish.
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I'm sure the Chamber will be pleased to hear the reassurance from the Cabinet Secretary that the Government has looked again at the funding decision. And indeed, we heard that outlined by the First Minister, I think, on Thursday, that this would be looked at again. I think everyone in the Chamber can agree that men's sheds are a linchpin in tackling poor mental wellbeing, isolation and loneliness. Taking that preventative approach, with thousands of men voluntarily engaging about their vulnerabilities for the first time. But I think it's clear that we have been here before. This is not an unusual situation in terms of the funding. And that the Men's Shed Association needs proper stability of funds to ensure that they can continue to have a huge impact on men's lives. So will the Government go a step further than the answer just now and say what longer-term funding options are being looked at by the Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it's important, Presiding Officer, to also ensure that we look not just at the national picture, but also the support that can be given to local Menshed. And those are two distinct areas which the Government is very keen to support. Now, the Member will be well aware that the SMSA are a national membership body that supports the establishment of Mensheds. That's distinct from the activities of the nearly 200 local sheds. So, while the SMSA provide a very valuable service, we do need to bear in mind that permanent core funding to every third sector organisation that would benefit from this potentially is not possible. We don't do that for every single third sector organisation. So what we do need to do is ensure that we're working with organisations like the SMSA, to look at financial sustainability in the long term. And that can't just be from Scottish Government funding, important though that is, but it can't just be around that, and it will include obviously looking at other avenues for their funding. So we are absolutely committed to working with them to ensure that that happens. We recognise the preventative nature of the work that Mensheds undertake and recognise that's important. But I do have to also point out to the member that support does remain available for local sheds. That's the Community Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for Adults, the Just Transition Participatory Budgeting Capital Fund and the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund. All of that work is continuing, but I'm happy, as I say in my original answer, to confirm that we will continue to support the national core funding as well as those funds that remain available for the locals Mensheds.
Thank you. Again, we must have concise questions and responses. Paul O'Kane.
Thank you. I do think the Cabinet Secretary would want to acknowledge the fact that the national organisation is extremely important in supporting that delivery on the ground. And without that umbrella organisation, many of the sheds wouldn't be able to do the work that they do. And I think this is evidence of a larger challenge in the third sector with sustainable funding, ensuring that processes are not complex, and ensuring that there is clarity of where funding is coming from. So would the Cabinet Secretary accept that changing decisions mid-year, not giving information on time, is a chaotic way in order to deliver funding, and it doesn't allow organisations like the Umbrella Organisation for Mensheds to function properly. So what is the Government going to do more widely to reset its strained relationship with the third sector and finally deliver on long-promised improved funding models?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Paul O'Kane rightly presents a challenge that Government does need to rise to. Can I gently suggest to him that it's not just the Scottish Government that needs to rise to that challenge, but the UK Government? So, for example, when the Scottish Government receives budgetary allocations exceptionally late in the day and we're providing the Scottish Government budget under tight timescales, that does ensure that there is more difficulty for the Scottish Government to be able to provide certainty for people. And I look forward to working with Paul O'Kane and others, if there is indeed a change at UK Government levels, in ensuring we receive timely notification of Scottish Government budgets. That way, Mr O'Kane and I can work together to support the sub-sector, as I'm sure he would like us to do.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I note the Minister, Cabinet Secretary, talks about the Mensheds receiving £795,000 directly. Now, we know that's been for a number of years, and not all that money was directed either. It was a culmination of several different funds that came together. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, we're talking about core funding here and now. Therefore, what is the Scottish Government going to do about ensuring that this life-saving movement is protected and properly funded in the long term going forward, because it's the long term that matters, Cabinet Secretary?
Cabinet Secretary.
I've just provided reassurance to the Chamber, Presiding Officer, that we will provide that funding for this financial year. But can I also say, across the Chamber, there is universal support for Mensheds, and quite rightly so. I've met with the Mensheds in my constituency of Dunfermline and recognise the fantastic work that they do. Other members will be in the same position. But again, I point out to the member that the Scottish Government does not provide core funding for every single third sector organisation within here. And that's why, yes, we need to provide funding where possible, but we also need to work with third sector organisations about where other funding opportunities may lie.
Colin Beattie.
Can the Cabinet Secretary say anything more about the different funding streams which the Scottish Government provides to support third sector organisations and which men's sheds may be able to benefit from?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. Well, I've pointed out to some of these already, but I can once again confirm that men's sheds can apply for and already benefit from a range of competitive funds that are available through their third sector interfaces in every local authority area. And I've discussed already the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund for Adults, Suggest Transition, Participatory Budgeting, Capital Fund, to mention but two. Local men's sheds have already secured funding from these monitored and assessed funding streams, and in addition, the Scottish Government provides £11.6 million funding to third sector intermediaries nationally and locally that provide development support to the full spectrum of third sector organisations, including men's sheds.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. As Paul Kane says, we're not in a new situation here, and as the Cabinet Secretary has already acknowledged, there's cross-party support for the men's shed movement. Indeed, I coordinated a letter supported by over 40 MSPs last year, where we wrote to the then Deputy First Minister, now First Minister, seeking a reversal of the decision to cut the funding last year. The Men's Shed Association is already garnering funding support from other sources, but this core funding is absolutely vital, and we cannot find ourselves in the same situation year after year after year. Now, in Mental Health Week, will the Cabinet Secretary give a commitment, a longer-term commitment, to providing this vital funding to a vital organisation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, once again, I would put on record the support, not just across the Chamber, but I want to specifically mention the work that Liam MacArthur has undertaken over a number of years on this issue. And he's quite right to point to the importance of providing this reassurance within Mental Health Awareness Week. I would say to Mr MacArthur, I think the Government has two responsibilities in this area. One, yes, it's to provide funding where possible, and budgetary restrictions are on every part of government. But the second responsibility is to work with third sector organisations and others to ensure that they are looking to be financially sustainable in the long term from a wide range of funders, and that can't just be from Scottish Government. So yes, we will look to and will always look to provide support wherever possible, but we will also look to support the men's sheds movement to see what can be done to ensure that they are financially sustainable and ensure that that's done in a way that doesn't just rely on one source of funding, whether that's Scottish Government or elsewhere.
Question number three, Fergus Ewing.
To ask the Scottish Government, in the event that the reported legal action raised against it by BIFA and any potential actions by other companies that incurred expenditure in expectation of the deposit return scheme being implemented are successful and lead to any financial losses, whether it will consider suing the UK Government in respect of any such losses in the light of its reported position that the UK Government is responsible for the scheme not proceeding in Scotland.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank you, President Officer. I'm sure Fergus Ewing will appreciate, as he was a former Cabinet Member, the Scottish Government cannot comment on ongoing litigation, and therefore I cannot comment on the substance of his question. However, the Scottish Government remains committed to the delivery of a deposit return system to realise the environmental and economic benefits it will bring. A Four Nations policy statement has been published to ensure the schemes across the UK are as simple as possible for consumers and businesses, while still respecting the devolved nature of these policies, and will continue to engage with industry and other nations across the UK to support the delivery of a DRS in 2027.
Fergus Ewing.
I do, as a former minister, appreciate that when it comes to litigation, then one's cards have to be kept close to, if not actually glued to one's chest. So I expected that answer. The minister will be aware that the taxpayer has lost £9 million from the Scottish National Investment Bank loan that will be a total write-off, that business may have incurred costs of possibly up to even £300 million, and that there was really a profoundly concerning dispute between the Scottish and UK Government, and, you know, perhaps with new leadership, a fresh start may now be appropriate. But could I just ask the Minister if the Scottish Government has yet considered, and if not, whether it will now consider holding an independent inquiry into not just what went so very badly wrong, but also how to avoid these mistakes should there be some scheme in the future at a UK and Scottish level.
Minister.
Thank you to Fergus Ewing for bringing that up. I just want to say, though, the Scottish Government did follow the agreed process and secured an exclusion from the UK Internal Market Act, engaging with the UK and devolved governments throughout the relevant common framework for 2 years. And UK ministers have publicly acknowledged that the Scottish Government followed the agreed process at all times. However, to a substantive point about going forward, along with other nations of the UK, obviously we'll be looking at how we take the DRS forward that is workable, that is within that whole common framework of how something could be actually simplified and rolled out across the UK, as I've mentioned in my initial answer.
Fergus Ewing.
There is, in my view, having met 41 meetings with businesses, meeting hundreds of businesses, and amongst those businesses, concerns that the defects in the previous scheme and any future scheme are so serious and so obvious that it may not be possible to fix them. In the spirit of goodwill and with the possibility of a fresh start to try and sort this out, given that there has been an almighty mess, will the Minister meet with me and a small group of the key business people who are most closely involved and therefore best able to explain their profound concerns so that the Minister and the Scottish Government can be better equipped and in a better position to avoid the disastrous mistakes that I believe were made with the previous scheme?
Minister.
In answer to Fergus Ewing, I'm happy to meet with Mr Ewing and any other businesses that he recommends could give an insight into to the difficulties that they anticipated with any scheme, and indeed to meet with anyone who is involved in dealing with the waste associated with the drinks containers and glass, plastic and cans that were proposed in the original deposit return scheme. So my answer is a simple yes.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I asked a committee last June, the then Minister couldn't or wouldn't say what the total business liability was. So, Minister, what is the total amount of losses covering both capital and revenue by business in preparation for Scotland's failed deposit return scheme?
Minister.
Well, I would like to gently point out to Maurice Golden that the Parliament agreed in this scheme, and it was the UK Government's refusal to agree a full exclusion from the Internal Market Act.
Let's hear the Minister.
I should say, in the 11th hour, that radically undermined the right of this Parliament to pass and deliver regulations in clearly devolved areas. Mr Golden mentions about the cost to businesses, but I would also add to that, what's the cost to the environment of the fact that this scheme is not in place?
Sarah Boyack.
Officer, the last Gateway review on the readiness of service, which Mr Ewing notably pursued the government on to be published, was published in July last year and concluded with a red amber status. And that meant successful delivery of the programme is in doubt, with major risks or issues apparent in a number of key areas. Urgent action is needed to ensure these are addressed and establish whether resolution is feasible. So how confident is the Scottish Government, given the reported legal action, that if they went down the route Mr Ewing has suggested, that they would be successful, and given that many businesses, including SMEs, providing support services in my Lothian region lost out and jobs were lost, why is it not engaged with businesses on compensation before now?
Minister.
Well, I'll just say to Sarah Boyack, I want to reiterate what I said in relation to talking about any kind of legal action. I cannot comment on litigation, and I won't do that. But I would say that as a result of the UK Government's intervention, that where conditions such as the removal of glass in alignment with other non-existing UK DRS, which didn't exist and we couldn't say whether we would be able to align with that because it wasn't even been mooted at all what that would involve, we maybe have got to a place where we can have a more sensible discussion amongst the four nations of the UK as to how we can take a deposit return scheme forward. And obviously I would say to Ms Boyack's party, should they be in government, that I very much look forward to working with their ministers in getting a solution for the whole of the UK.
Mark Crustill.
The Secretary of State for Scotland made the unilateral decision to block Scotland's deposit return scheme. He has refused to come to this Parliament to explain that decision to MSPs and has failed to provide the evidence requested from both Scottish and Welsh governments as to why he excluded glass from the UK scheme, which is now, as the Minister rightly says, a non-existent scheme. The decision has made a mockery of the devolved settlement. So can the Minister say what the wider impact has been on policymaking here in this Parliament when we have a UK government prepared to act in a reckless way, cheered on by those who do not have the interests of Scotland's environment at their heart?
Minister, in relation to the substantive question.
Well, not only do I agree with Mark Ruskell, I would go further and I say that there were processes put in place, particularly common frameworks, to avoid such an outcome. And that the Scottish Government ministers, whose colleague Lorna Slater, worked hard to engage with those common frameworks to get agreement. The deposit return scheme for Scotland regulations are wholly within devolved competence, were approved by the Scottish Parliament in 2020. However, the Internal Market Act, imposed without our consent, by the way, radically undermines the power of the Scottish Parliament, and Mr Ruskell is right in his appraisal of them.
Mr Carson, I would be grateful if you would resist the temptation to contribute from your seat. Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was interested in the Minister's response to Fergus Hume regarding businesses, and in the interest of making progress, can I invite the Minister to visit Dryden Aqua in my constituency, which was never visited before? It's a profitable, eco-friendly glass recycling company which grinds down the bottles into particles to replace sand filters in, for example, swimming pools, significantly reducing chlorine oxidation. Never visited before. There's existing glass recycling in Scotland. Let's at least, if the Minister would visit these first.
Minister.
I'm happy to go to any visit in Christine Graham's constituency, but that sounds like an excellent scheme. Obviously, I've got responsibility now in circular economy, so of course anyone who wants me to visit an organisation who's involved in those efforts, I'm happy to oblige.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 13203 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the Stage 3 consideration of the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill. I ask any member who wishes to speak on the motion to press their request to speak button, and I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
It moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 13203 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed.